You're listening to Just Hit Play with your hosts, Peter and Nick Cabral. If you're tired of your stagnant, streamed music feed, then strap yourselves in for an intergenerational sonic journey through Peter and Nick's favorite songs.
Welcome to episode 93 of Just Hit Play. I'm your host, Peter. With me is my co-host, Nick. Nick, how you doing, man?
I'm doing excellent. I'm in a great mood because today I wrote my last exam of the semester, and I'm officially finished with school for 4 months. Got a nice bit of time off now, and I'm really excited about it because it's been a hard past 3 weeks with school and everything, so feels like a big weight off my shoulders, and I'm in a great mood.
Do you have much plan for the 4 months that you have coming up?
Not too much. A few concerts here and there. Mm-hmm. Loose plans with friends, bunch of Jays games, some Toronto FC games, stuff like that. But really just trying to work, make some money, and enjoy life to the fullest.
That's good. That's good. Now, I want to ask you a question before we start.
Sure.
You sent me a message. I believe you listened to the Nevermind album.
Yes, the Nirvana album I did.
Yeah, so tell me what your thoughts were.
Yeah, so the night we recorded our last episode, I was talking about Nirvana and how much I loved Pennyroyal Tea, and I put on Nevermind at your recommendation and listened to it while I was playing some video games, relaxing after studying, and yeah, it just blew me away. Like, I loved that album, and I knew the first few songs. Mm-hmm.
Like Come As You Are.
Come As You Are, yeah. In Bloom. Yeah. Those songs, knew those. But the rest of the album, I think after track 4, was all new to me. And really good. Just excellent. They weren't like the typical Nirvana mold I was expecting. There was a lot of really good lyrical stuff. The music was great. Really raw and complex, which I wasn't expecting. So yeah, I really loved it.
Well, now you have to listen to In Utero. I don't know if you did get a chance to listen to In Utero, but you can see where Nirvana was trying to go with In Utero. And some of it works and some of it doesn't. So you can give that a shot next.
Cool. Yeah, I definitely will get around to it when I have the time.
Yeah. Cool. Well, let's get into some music. So you're going first this week. So tell us about your Australian band.
Yes. So I've actually been waiting to do this song, or at least a song by this group named 1/4 for a while. They're probably the only Australian music I know, or the only Australian hip hop music I know, and hip hop being my favorite genre. So I've had this one in the chamber for a while. I thought with our discussion on Vince Staples' North North last week, and some recent current events, that it'd be a good time to do 1/4 on the podcast. So as I said, they're an Australian group. They originated from Mount Druitt. I don't know if I said that correctly, but that's a neighborhood of Sydney, Australia.
Sounds about right.
Yeah, right. And their music is heavily inspired by the UK drill subgenre of hip hop, with bassy electronic beats and really aggressive rapping of lyrics about gang culture and things of that nature. So the first song of theirs I ever heard, and my favorite, is Brakes and Caddies. And Darren, why don't you just hit play on 1/4?
Oh, fuck. Hurry up. I'm trying. Hurry up. Fuck, you had me move. Brakes and caddies. My young heater.
You ready? Yeah, there you go.
From this big old shoddy, from here to my reset, I create holes like this. PM, hold that stick when I rock my split, cause we ain't solving shit.
Alright, so I know this song is pretty intense. You may have thought that it was a lot overwhelming or whatever, but give me your thoughts on it. I want to hear what your visceral initial reaction was to Brakes and Caddies.
As I've said in the past, one of the reasons why I don't like Australian hip hop is the accent. I don't think the accent lends itself to the genre. And this song is no different. I really dislike this song. You know what it is, Nick? I think they're like playing dress up. you know, living in Australia, like, I know there's crime and there are people that steal cars, and, you know, in living in Sydney, it's a big city and there's a lot of urban crime and stuff like that. But it's not like this. This is bogus. Like, this is there's no, you know, it's not like America where, you know, there's a great divide between the haves and the have-nots. Don't get me wrong, there is a divide here between the haves and have-nots. But it's not to the point where this happens. I think they're playing dress-up. So to me, it's not real. They could get a job and do whatever they want. They're not being downtrodden. There's no racial tension unless you're Aboriginal. There's a great hip hop Aboriginal movement in Australia. The Aboriginal people in Australia are treated horribly. These guys, as far as I can tell, they're not Aboriginal. So they have more than enough opportunity to not steal cars and write about it.
All right. So lots unpacked there. Yes, a lot there of hot is. Takes.
Yeah.
As far as the music itself, we'll get into the rest after. I personally love the Australian accent. Because
it drives me crazy.
I've heard so much drill music that doesn't have an Australian accent. A lot with like a UK accent, which I guess is pretty similar. So I'm used to the accent. Right. And I thought the Australian accent just made everything sound even more like gritty and like raw. And I like that a lot. And I think what sets 1-4 apart musically from other people who make this sort of music is their energy. Like, they're like going at 100 the entire duration of the song. So that's really what drew me to them. And what makes them stand out for me is just that energy and how aggressive and like fervent it is. Like, it's just in your face constantly, just punching you with bass and synths and everything. Yep. So loved that. And I think the music video is cool too, from like an editing perspective. I thought it was really well done.
Yeah, it seems like they were going back and forth and almost like talking to each other, and like one artist was in one side of, you know, the city responding to what the other artist was saying. So that was pretty cool. I did think that was pretty clever. That was cleverly done.
Yeah. I completely agree. And when I heard this song for the first time, it was with the music video too. Like, my friend Marcelo was over and he's like, have you ever heard of 1-4? And I said, no. And he loves drill music. So he's like, okay, right, put this video on and put it on like my 4K TV with the sound system and subwoofer. And it just blew me away.
Right.
So yeah, that definitely helped in my enjoyment of the song just because of how cinematic it all was. Really immersive.
Now, you know how we talked about different scenarios where we listen to music, whether it's driving or listening to music on headphones. This is definitely loudspeaker kind of music, where you're driving a car and you know, the music is loud because that's what it calls for. Yeah,
absolutely. This is music you have to play on a speaker. You got to play it loud. Best enjoyed with other people to get hype with. I think that's definitely what this music is for, what this song is for. But I wanted to play this song in particular, and I alluded to it earlier, because I'm not sure if you've heard or read anything about this, but 1-4 has been in the news quite a bit recently.
Mm. No, I haven't heard anything.
So a month ago, Sydney had its Royal Easter Show, which is apparently the largest ticketed event in Australia. And the event, the organizers banned, and this is a direct quote, rapper music from the entire Sydney Royal Easter Show.
Right. Yeah.
For alleged public safety concerns. And when I say they banned rapper music, I don't mean they like just banned rappers from performing. Like, any rap music played in the event grounds at all. So like a popcorn vendor with a Bluetooth speaker, for example, can't play Drake music, or like, you know, can't play hip hop, or they would have been like kicked out of the event. So that that made like international news, at least like in my circles, like people I follow on Twitter were retweeting these articles and saying like, isn't this crazy? So I thought that was pretty shocking to me. Like even just the term rapper music seems like a dog whistle to me. I don't know if you agree, but it's pretty shocking.
Without going too much in depth into Australia history or Australia's history of racism or of what Australia does, let me say a couple things. In the Australian Parliament in Canberra, which is the capital of Australia, they didn't put a female bathroom in there until like the 80s. Aboriginal people weren't seen as people, I think, until the 70s. Like they weren't written, like they were not written into the constitution until about the 70s. They were treated almost like chattel. Australia does have a long history of racism, and even their more liberal governments, the Labor governments, are quite conservative. So this does not surprise me at all. I think in the upper echelon, in the city fathers, this kind of stuff probably happens a lot. Not in the youth culture, not in, you know, the everyday life, but in the government and things like that. This sounds pretty typical Australian.
Yeah, and I agree with you, like with knowing the history and the higher level things that happen in Australian political culture, I agree with you that it's not surprising, but at first glance, it is surprising because this is something you would expect to see in like a Southern American state, you know, like maybe a country fair in Texas would ban rap music, but the largest event in Australia, it caught me by surprise. And I think a lot of people as well, because I don't know if the international world or people in other countries view Australia as being regressive in some senses. I think it was a bit surprising, but at the same time, again, not surprising because Australia banned Tyler, the Creator from going to there. Like until 2019, he was banned from the country. Yep. Snoop Dogg was banned from Australia for a while.
He was.
So they do have a history of things of this nature for sure.
Well, even Post Malone was in Australia recently and he tried to get into a nightclub after one of his concerts and he was refused entry into the nightclub because of his tattoos. So there is a policy in Australia that if you have gang tattoos or bikers is a big problem here in Australia. There's a lot of bike gangs that deal drugs and are more involved in crime. So he was denied entry into a nightclub because of his tattoos. Obviously they didn't know who Post Malone was. Now I disagree with not allowing someone into a nightclub because of their tattoos. I'm totally for not allowing Post Malone into a club because his music is awful. That's fine. But to discriminate against him for his tattoos, okay, I can understand where he would be a little upset by that and find that a little bit weird.
Well, agree to disagree. I do like some Post Malone songs, but I hear you. That's very strange. And the whole Royal Easter Show thing came about a month after New South Wales police shut down a 1-4 performance at a boxing world title match. In March, they were set to do like a performance during like the night, like during the event of one of their new songs. And the police like came in and like stopped them all, like detained them and said, you know, we're not, if you go on stage, we're arresting you.
Yep.
Type thing. About a month prior to that, the police put out a statement saying they're going to call Spotify and ask them to take 1-4's music down off the platform. And yeah, it's just pretty crazy. Oh,
yeah.
And then 2019, their first Australian tour was canceled because police were putting pressure on all the venues that had booked the tour, threatening to fine the venue owners and everyone if they allowed 1-4 to perform at their venues and go on this tour. So this has led a lot of people to start referring to 1-4 as Australia's NWA, just in the sense of how they're being harassed and antagonized and persecuted by the police and media in Australia. So as someone who is alive and around for the NWA, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, there's a lot of similar aspects to that. And this ties in perfectly with our episode last week where when you try to ban music or you try to ban performances or artists, that just increases their popularity with the kids that want to listen to that music. So really, they should have just left them alone. Now, you know the band Bare Naked Ladies, I'm guessing.
Yes.
They were. I don't know if I talked to you about this one. They were going to perform a New Year's Eve show, and they were canceled off the show because their name was the Bare Naked Ladies. And what happened? They became very popular because, without even hearing their music, because they were banned, they became a very popular band. So the key is not to do this and let artists perform. And if they're good, they'll sell successfully. If they're bad, they'll just fall away. So banning artist is not the right way to go about it if you don't want people to listen to that music.
I completely agree. And I think that if I had to speculate on the true aim behind like not letting them perform live and canceling their tours and everything, I think it's really to just stop them or block them from getting like paid for performing, like paid for live performances, and to really try to like kill that culture of live music. Right. When it comes to this genre, which is pretty bad and messed up on a lot of different levels that we don't have to get into because we've already talked about censoring music a ton on this podcast.
Yes, we have.
But it's just interesting, I think, because so many of our discussions in previous episodes have been centered around America and what happens in America. Mm-hmm. And I think what happens with One Four in Australia is a good reminder that these things aren't just isolated to one part of the world and can happen anywhere, given absolutely. The right circumstances.
Yeah. I don't like the song, but it has nothing to do with the politics of it. I think it's just I don't like the way Australian accent sounds in hip hop. I don't think they should not be played. Allow them to do whatever they want. And if you're an audience member that likes this kind of music, go see them play, buy their records, listen to them on Spotify. A censorship is wrong on every single level.
Yeah, completely agree. And I do just want to fact check you because you did say you thought they were playing Dress Up with this song.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, please correct me. If I'm speaking incorrectly, correct me. Yeah.
So their name, One Four, stems from the street gang that they've been affiliated with, which is called NF14. Yep. It's a gang in Sydney. So they took the 1-4 from 14, made that their name. Right. One of their core members has been in jail for, I think, some type of assault. He's been in jail for the last 3 years. At one point, they had 4 of their 5 members all in jail at the same time for various charges and cases. There's a lot of active investigations ongoing into their gang ties. And what I think makes it worse that they're being censored is that they actually are making music about their lived experiences. Like it is actually genuine. They aren't being disingenuous and making music about things they have no idea about, and trying to, you know, incite people to do things that they themselves aren't doing or have never done. They're actually rapping about what they're doing. They're in the streets, you know, doing these things, and for better or for worse, you know, if people hear music about it, that's a whole separate discussion, obviously, but it's not fake. And to me, that makes it better because it's actually authentic.
Okay. So I'm going to put once this episode is released, I'm going to put out a poll on our Instagram page to see what people think about Australian hip hop, whether people like it or they don't. Obviously, we have a lot of people that listen to this podcast who live in Australia, and we have a lot of people listen to this podcast that don't live in Australia. So this would be a good chance for everyone to have their say, whether you like this type of genre or if you don't. So yeah, look on the Instagram page for a poll coming up.
My guess is about 6% of people say they like Australian hip hop.
Yeah. You know, strangely, when my song comes up, I am going to talk a little bit about Australian hip hop as well. So, yeah.
Oh, interesting. I can't wait to see how you manage to connect your song to Australian hip hop. But
let's do it.
Yeah. But real quick, Darren, what'd you think about Breaks and Caddies? Is this going on your playlist?
No, definitely not. Also, Their lead singer is New Zealander, so we don't take responsibility. He's not Australian.
There you go.
There you go. There you go. He's a New Zealander.
Yeah, so that's a whole different other.
Actually, yeah, I think he got deported to New Zealand recently, actually. Yeah.
A lot of people are getting deported to New Zealand. Yeah. Yeah, we have a very conservative government and a very conservative police. Darren, without getting too much into it, I've been told that the police force in Queensland in the 90s and the 80s was very fascist and very authoritarian. Can you confirm or deny this?
They did have their issues. I don't know them exactly because it was before my time, but they did have their issues.
Yes. There's many charges leveled at the Queensland, where I live. I live in Brisbane, Queensland. What the Brisbane or Queensland police were like in the 90s and 80s. So they were very, like they would break up. Like if there was a lot of people hanging out together, they would break up, like, you know, meetings that people were having, things like that. So it was apparently quite an interesting police force.
Interesting. I'm going to have to do some independent research on that.
Yeah. All right. Are you ready to listen to some San Cisco?
I am. Yeah. Let's completely switch up the genre and mood here. Get into some happy pop.
They could not be any more different, could they? So we're going to listen to a song called Awkward by San Cisco, who are from Fremantle in Western Australia, which is a suburb of Perth, Australia. So Darren just hit play on Awkward. So there's San Cisco with the song Awkward, which is a bit of indie pop. Tell me what you thought of the song.
Yeah, I mean, obviously I love this song. It's right up my alley. It's just a really cool and fun little early 2000s indie song. Like, it's just a fun vibe, I guess, you know? It sounds a lot like Two Door Cinema Club. I don't know if you're familiar with Two Door Cinema Club.
Yeah, I
love this type of music. When I was first starting to get into indie and expand my music taste, songs and bands like this were really pivotal to that. So I'm actually surprised they've flown under my radar, but this is a good song. I like it a lot.
I think what attracted me first to this song was, obviously I love the poppiness, the guitar sound is really, really good. But once the female singer starts in, who's the drummer of the band, I wasn't expecting it to be like that too dynamic song. Especially the first time I heard it, I was like, oh, that's really interesting and different than how I expected the song to be. So I really like the dynamic between the two singers of the song.
Yeah, they've got a really cool interplay and chemistry that I agree. I think that's what makes the song special. Just the differences in their singing and how they also harmonize together. I think that's really good. And with this song and others like it, I think it's an interesting paradox where on the surface, the song is very simple. Maybe not much to it. It's not a very complex sonically. But I think it's to such an extent that it circles back around again to being pretentious, how simple it is.
Yeah.
Do you agree?
Yeah, it's so simple. Which goes to show you can be successful, and this is one of the most successful songs that this band has written. You can be successful with just a simple, simple song. It does not have to be complex. You can just write a nice pop song.
Yeah, like it's just two chords, the whole song. But it's executed so well that it becomes artsy and good and well done. Just on the merits of how they execute it. So
yeah. I first heard this song on a radio station called Triple J. So when I first moved to Australia, Triple J was on high rotation. It's part of ABC. So ABC would be the Australian Broadcasting Company, which is close to the CBC or the BBC. It's government funded. So because of that, there's no ads. So they have no ads on the radio station. So it's all just government funded. I really loved Triple J when I first moved to this country. I can't listen to Triple J anymore. One of the reasons why I can't listen to Triple J anymore is because they've sort of moved from the alternative side of things, and they play a lot of, like, they play Beyonce, Lil Nas X. So they're going mainstream in a weird way, and they play so much Australian hip hop now. So I can't listen to that radio station anymore. So now I curate my own music in my car when I'm driving. I no longer listen to Triple J.
Probably no 1-4 though.
Probably not. They do have, I think they do have a hip hop segment every night on the show where they do play nothing but hip hop. So they could play them then, but I don't know. I don't listen to that radio station anymore.
Yeah, fair enough. The accent would preclude you from that.
Do you know what the slang for Australian hip hop is?
No.
It's skip hop.
Skip hop. Interesting.
The reason why skip? There was a character. I think I might have watched this before. There was a TV show about a kangaroo called Skippy, who would get into trouble or solve crimes. I don't know, Darren. What did Skippy do? What did Skippy the kangaroo do?
I can't remember. Basically, think Lassie, but with instead of a dog, it's a kangaroo.
Yeah. So the name of the bloody kangaroo was Skippy, and so that's just skip hop is a term that's used sometimes to describe Australian hip hop.
That sounds so like fun and innocent, though. You know, not like rapping about like holding a knife to someone's neck and taking their car and like stuff like that.
Well, even in that video, going back to your song, there was a scene where there was like a drive-by shooting. They're using like an Uzi or an AK-47 or something. And I was like, come on. Like, that's what I've meant about the play acting side of things. Like, that just felt so ridiculous to be doing that in the suburbs of Sydney.
Yeah, I think that was definitely a little egregious.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's art, right? Like that you play things up. Absolutely. For, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So going back to San Cisco, the name San Cisco literally means nothing. They wanted to, like the Smiths, they chose a name that was just like a blank canvas that absolutely meant nothing. So it gave you no direction. It gave the listener no direction of what the sound would be. So it has nothing to do with San Francisco. It's literally San Cisco and has no affiliation to anything.
I actually like that name a lot. And it goes back to that paradox where it's so simple that it becomes pretentious. Like, I think that is very evident with this band, and they really display that. And I think that's really what, like, twee pop is all about. Are you familiar with the term twee pop?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is twee pop to the max. With that, absolutely, like, jangly, the jangly melody and, like, the whimsical, innocent aesthetic. It's very simple, very light, but something about it. You know, it's something about it. It's just really fun to listen to.
It's a great pop song. It's just so simple and just pleasant to listen to.
Exactly. It's pleasant. It's a pleasant song. Yeah. I would listen to this on a summer day in the park.
Yeah. Yeah. No.
The breeze going. You nailed it. And just, perfectly, just have a good time.
I love Perth. I've been to Perth a couple times. I'd move to Perth if there was job opportunities for me to go to Perth. And obviously if Angie agreed that she wanted to go to Perth. if you ever come visit again, we definitely have to do a drive. We definitely have to fly to Perth. I think if we drove to Perth, it would take us 2 weeks. We definitely have to fly to Perth and, go explore, because it's an interesting town. It's the most isolated capital city in the world. There's literally nothing around Perth.
Wow.
So you drive an hour outside of Perth and you're in the outback. It's quite unique. It's a very unique city.
That sounds fantastic.
Yeah.
Honestly, it sounds really good.
Yeah, it's a cool city. It's very expensive to live there, obviously, because it is so isolated, but it's a great little town.
Cool. Yeah. Definitely have to check it out.
Yeah. Darren, had you ever heard San Cisco before? What did you think of the song?
I like it. It's a nice poppy song, and Triple J used to play it a hell of a lot, so that's how it got on my playlist.
Yeah. Triple J has a top 100 they play every year, and this made it to number 7 on the top 100. So I believe it's the highest charting song that San Cisco ever had. And this is from their first EP in 2011, as you said.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
All right. What song do you have for me for next week?
All right. So for next week, you're going to listen to the song Tether by the band Churches, I believe. I don't actually know how to say the band's name, but I believe Churches, it's Churches.
It is, yeah.
Do you know the band? Do you know the song, Tether?
I don't know the song, but I do know the band.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. And you, sir, are going to listen to another Australian song. So Nick has asked me for me to play him some newer songs that I've been listening to. So you're going to listen to a band called Art Versus Science. And the song is Parlez-vous Français.
Cool.
That's the name of the song.
Some Australian French music, huh?
I'm going to get you to listen to two versions of this song. I'm going to get you to listen to the single version. And I found a live performance of this song that is just amazing. So I'm going to get you to listen to both. So I'm going to give you links to the live and the studio recording of that song.
All right. Looking forward.
Cool. All right. Let's get into This Week in Music History. This one's pretty neat. In this date in 1973, Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon went to number one in the U.S. The album went on to enjoy a record-breaking 641 discontinuous weeks on the Billboard charts. Think about that. 741 weeks on the Billboard charts and has now sold over 45 million copies. So Dark Side of the Moon is one of those records that sells a lot of records every year, and it's always in the charts for whatever reason. It's just one of those albums that does that. So we're going to listen to a brief snippet from a song called Money from Dark Side. Have you ever listened to Dark Side of the Moon?
Of course. Come on.
Yeah. Okay. Good album. Yeah.
One of my first forays into alt rock or psychedelic rock was Dark Side of the Moon. Listened to it pretty young. What's your favorite song on Dark
Money
Side of the Moon? Is it Money?
Money's my favorite song.
Okay. Time for me.
Time is also a really good song. It's one of those albums, isn't it? That just, you know, you can just sit and listen to the whole album and spend an hour or so just listen to that album.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Yeah. So if you have a listener, if you haven't listened to Dark Side of the Moon, put it on, sit in a dark room, loud speakers. If you want to smoke something, that's up to you. But it's a very, very good album.
Very good album.
And in the year 2000 on this date, a blaze swept through James Brown Enterprises, the office that coordinated the Superstars tours. Nobody was injured, but memorabilia, live tapes were all destroyed in the blaze. So James Brown, a very interesting character who's no longer with us. He's been arrested a few times. He's spent a bit of time in jail. And we're going to listen to a James Brown song called Papa Got a Brand New Bag. Very famous for his music being used in a lot of samples, James Brown, in modern age. Incredible artist, really interesting character, really messed up character, but a lot of his music got made into samples.
So there's a line in an ASAP Rocky verse where he says, mm-hmm. James Brown swag, Papa's got a brand new bag. Yeah. I had no idea what he was talking about, and now I do.
Yeah, it's a James Brown song. That's my favorite James. My favorite James Brown song is "Papa Got a Brand New Bag." Great song, very, very. You can dance to that song. Not that I dance, but if I could dance, that's a good song to dance to.
Tell me you never danced.
I might have danced once or twice. I might have a ribbon of a. I came third in a dance contest once when I was in grade eight, but it was the twist. Anyone can do the twist. It's nothing to be proud of.
Hey, I think you should be proud of that. Own up to that.
It was third place in a very small competition. I think there might have been four different dance partners in that competition. So let's say
the fourth was my dad.
No, this was when I was in elementary school. So so I was with my peers that couldn't dance. At least one couple couldn't dance as well as I could. That's enough of that. What's your plans for the rest of the week?
Well, I think I'm just going to try to make the most of freedom, my temporary freedom. My school's got like a semi-formal / pub night party thing tomorrow night. So I'm going to be going to that. And yeah, just having fun this weekend. That's my plan. Going out, enjoying life, enjoying the nice weather. And yeah, I'm really looking forward to it.
I'm photographing a wedding on Saturday. So it's in the town of Esk, which is in the country. I'm really looking forward to photographing that wedding. So that's my plans for the weekend.
Oh, I'm also on Sunday going to see Star Wars Return of the Jedi in theaters. They're re-releasing it in theaters for the anniversary.
Are they really?
So I'm going to go to that. Yeah, 50-year anniversary.
Nice.
Yeah,
40-year anniversary.
Yeah, quickly, about 20 years ago, they released Star Wars into theaters again, and I got really, really high before I went to go see Star Wars. And I told my friend at the time that I'd get candy, and the person at the candy counter talked me into a lot of candy because it all sounded wonderful. And I probably spent like $30 just on candy, and I showed up with carrying a lot of popcorn and whatever else I came. And it was quite embarrassing because I was really, really high. Allegedly.
$30. That's probably like 3 bags of candy, though, to be honest.
Well, this was 20 years ago, so it was probably 5 bags.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. all right, let's get into our independent artist. So this week we have Braden Much, who also wrote our theme song for our podcast. And he got married a couple weeks ago. So congratulations, Braden, on your wedding.
Congratulations.
And he's recorded a new song. Only the Strong Survive. So this is what the song is about. The song is a realistic look at relationships within the context of daily struggle. I'm a big fan of old R&B ballads by Etta James and Anything by Jeff Buckley. So here's my attempt. I was living in a small condo in downtown Toronto with no furniture and a great view, much like Nick probably is today. I was living with my fiance, who's now my wife, and we were going through some ups and downs like any couple trying to survive in this city. Statistically, 50% of marriages end in divorce, so hence the title. So thanks, Braden. And let's give a song a spin, and we'll talk to you guys next week.
I leave early in the morning. Now I'm coming home late. I've left our faith in an unhealthy place. There's a difference between living just trying to stay alive. When it comes to love, only the strong survive. We're sleeping with the light on, believing me. You want to know how I feel? And what I say sounds harsh. So much distance between what we say. What we say we feel inside. When it comes to love, only the strong survive. I'm leaving. don't you give in to the fear? There's nowhere else I'm going. I'm staying right here. You're talking in your sleep, and you don't have much to say. It seems like the only time I'm listening to you anyway. Let's get down to the truth. Stop living these lies. When it comes to love, only the strong survive.
You've been listening to Just Hit Play. To contact your hosts, Peter and Nick, or to be featured on an episode as musical talent, email justhitplay7300@gmail.com. Keep up to date with news and announcements by following on Instagram and Facebook, linked in the show notes. Subscribe on your favorite podcatcher to tune in next week for more Sonic Delights. And if you can't wait till then, check out the Just Hit playlist on Spotify, linked in the show notes. A special thanks to Braden Munch for the theme song, and thank you for listening.